Good morning, everybody. I welcome all of you here. I'm not welcoming you here as director of NNML. I'm making it very clear this is not an NNML function. I'm welcoming you as one of the two editors of this book. Very grateful to Ambassador Parthasarathy for being present here. While people know him as a very eminent diplomat, which he definitely is, has been. He has very deep links with Sardar Patel, very, very deep links. One, of course, is that when Prime Minister wanted this very detailed work done on Sardar Patel, and you can see the exhibition today at the National Science Museum, a very good, technologically up-to-date, Ambassador Parthasarathy headed that group which did it. It was under his chairmanship that it was done. He, of course, feels that it needs more publicity. A lot of hard work has gone into it. And it is located in a science museum. So obviously, these potential clients, in that sense, are not accessing it. Children who go to the science museum also see, which is not a bad thing, but obviously their scope. Second, of course, is a much longer association in terms of the word G in his name. There were two Gopalaswamis in those days. One was, of course, Gopalaswami Iyengar, who was minister without portfolio, and who figures in the Nehru-Patel dialogue frequently. The other was his father, an eminent civil servant, who worked very closely with Sardar Patel. So as I said, for more grounds than one, he is the right person to be here with us. Speaking a bit on the book, it has taken us a long time in making. We started with a very large group of people who were asked to contribute chapters. We did two rounds of discussion and iteration, and some fell off. Some simply fell off because the kind of levels we wanted to achieve, we were very obvious that even after the improvement, those papers would never reach the level of the book, so we dropped it off. And then we had the final conference, which was open to the public, 2 days, after which again the chapter writers had to go back and work on it. It was definitely not a report of proceedings, of course, because the six, seven months of work behind it, but also the work that required after that. The very, very many aspects of Sardar Patel that we thought were not very well highlighted. Sardar Patel, the integrator of, or the creator of modern Indian cartography, is fairly well known now. Two recent books, Hindal's and Narasimha's Sense book, goes into a lot of details in it. And Narasimha's book particularly looks at the very specifics of how the different princes were negotiating with each other and what were they doing and what games were they playing, etc. Hindal takes a little larger view of it, going back much earlier on to the beginning of the Gandhi-Patel relationship from Kheda upwards, and again goes into a lot of detail. But this really looks, what we attempt to look at Patel from all kinds of view, the administrator, the municipal administrator, his heroic role in the Ahmedabad municipality, as an example, is links with industry, economic policies. You know, so it's, if you just look at the thing, Patel and minorities, for a person who was chairman of the subcommittee on all these rights, fundamental rights and the rights of the minorities, etc., Sir Patel gets a flack very occasionally for being anti-minority, or even being communal. I think if you read the chapter, you know it's completely. How in the evolving situation, and Balaji Ranganath really goes into a very detailed, literally psychological analysis of what he calls it, contesting masculinities, going back to the Gujarat Sabha and the Kheda Sabha. That said, I'm not going into details of all these things. All we wanted to do in our work was to really present Sardar Patel as a multi-dimensional personality, a very important part of the making of modern India that we know today. His whole role from the time he enters the public field under the influence of Mahatma Gandhi till he passes away in December 1950. And of course a very complex and relationship between the Sardar, the Mahatma and Pandit Nehru. I don't think so any three people could have been closer to each other franker with each other, had disagreements with each other, and the kind of language sometimes they use with each other. If this is what you think I'm doing, then I'm going home, kind of a thing, you know. You know, it's a very frank, it's a very personal relationship. But it's also a relationship which brings out the tensions at different times, which is, people can hide it or people can exaggerate it. Neither is correct. I think there is a dynamism to that relationship which has to be appreciated, which has gone into the making so much of modern India that we know today. A lot of people that I know are very upset about the civil services, but at that moment of time, Sardar Patel, who basically pushed the idea of continuation of the civil services, explaining and actually getting angry with, again, with Mr. Angar in the Constituent Assembly, saying that you, of all people, should not be criticizing the civil services. You know, at a time of partition, what an important role they have been playing, how the deep cuts they have endured. Patel, again, we don't associate somebody with at all with economic policies, really, other than the fact that his critics called him that he's very close to businessmen. But he had his very good views on the economy. He had his views on how to mobilize the producers also. And Amul is a standing example of that. It was because Paulson, the big company which then existed, it doesn't exist anymore. Some of us grew up with Paulson butter. Paulson has now gone, of course. But it was how Paulson was badly treating the farmers of Kheda that the whole thing, Anand, that the whole thing of Amul comes about, you know. So again, these are, you know, we tend to think of people in very simple terms, pro-capitalist, anti-capitalist, pro-socialist, anti-socialist. And I think Patel shows that that is not really true. But yes, he was with Mahatma in resisting the pressure of the Congress socialists in trying to push a socialist agenda onto the Congress party. He said, if you guys are so keen, go to the field and get it. You don't use the back door of the Congress party to do so. So there were Bose and Nehru and Jayaprakash Narayan and the others on the other side. So as I said, all in all I can say is that a fascinating personality. We should know more, much more about him and others like it, others like him. Because that whole period from the First World War effectively to the independence really saw a lot of churn in the country. Some could take it back even to the Bengal partition and the rise of the Balpala. But even then, if you even limit it to this period, the tremendous amount of churn that the country went through, which went into the creation again and again, as I'm stressing, of the modern India. The princely India, the British India, the metropolitan India, the rural India, all of that it impacted. And that is what we have tried to present in this book. So once again, let me welcome all of you here. Now request, do this first or do you want Ambassador Patha to speak first? Is it correct, Rajana?
You know,
we are telecast live, incidentally.
You know, one of my important connections with him date back to the fact that he was virtually the gatekeeper of Mr. Vajpayee. And all of us, landing up from places like Pakistan, had to travel through Shakti Sinha to Mr. Vajpayee. So it's been a wonderful relationship. Coming to this book, and I'll come to a... I think it is crucial that we get an alternative narrative. For too long have stereotypes been built up about leading figures in the freedom struggle. Yes, two individuals of great stature can never have the same thinking. They can't be one individual. And to be honest with you, ideologically, in terms of both in economics and in foreign policy, I can testify when Professor Roy and I have discussed this at some length. Panditji and Sardar Patel were poles apart. But what is important is they worked together for a common cause of Indian independence. And that is what is crucial. I would urge, since a lot of students are here, do visit what Mr. Sinha said as the National Science Center. You have an exhibition called Uniting India, Ek Bharat, Shrestha Bharat. It is a booklet on that exhibition. It's an exhibition we worked on for almost 1.5 years. And I must say that contrary to popular mention that the Prime Minister is very rigid about his point of view, I have worked with every Prime Minister since Jawaharlal Nehru. And you don't reach that position easily. And may I say, like Mr. Nehru or Indira Ji or Vajpayee Ji, Sardar Sahab was a man of great patience, and just to put the contemporary record straight, 18 months I worked with Mr. Modi on this exhibition. To him it was anything concerning Sardar Patel is an article of faith. And he never interfered as long as he believed that my team, and the list of that team is given in the end. Dr. Rani Shankar Das, who wrote the first biography of his in the 80s, Amrita Patel, H.M. Patel's daughter and of fame from Gujarat, Tridip Surud and Saroj Ghosh, both experts. And interestingly, a gentleman called Atul Tiwari, who wrote the script. And now I'll narrate a little thing. I contacted Atul Tiwari through Shyam Benegal. He was brilliant. I mean, both in Hindi, especially the Hindi transcript. And then I found some of the bureaucrats raising an objection that he is a card-holding member of the Communist Party. You know, when I told this to Mr. Modi, he almost laughed. And he and Tiwari worked so well. So whether as a national purpose, you don't allow small things to come in the way. And when you visit this exhibition, the entire script is written by Atul, who was Shyam Benegal's scriptwriter. And he still is Shyam Benegal's scriptwriter. So I think what is important, what Sardar Patel taught us, that you could transcend differences for national purposes. Let us be very, very clear. Ideologically, he was to the right of center. He believed in a free economy. If you read that famous letter which Sardar Patel wrote to Panditji about Chinese intentions, it was drafted for him in consultation with the Secretary General of External Affairs, Girija Shankar Bajpai, whose son was my senior colleague. We recently celebrated his 90th birthday. So, you know, the freedom struggle in the years beyond it, people had a much broader mind. You didn't get involved in petty differences. And the great thing was the ideological differences were there. And I personally believe that the best thing which could have happened was if he had lived somewhat longer and we could have got clear ideological positions within the Congress Party and within political India, because it moved leftwards. And Panditji had the stature to do it. On this exhibition itself and on Sardar's life, I forgot to tell Shaktiji that I got some very interesting information from a good friend of his, Jairam Ramesh, who spent a lot of time here, who sent me an exchange of letters 10 days after Sardar died. Nehru writing a letter of complaint to N. Gopal Swami Iyengar, who succeeded Sardar Patel as the Minister for States, about his less than pleasant meeting with a civil servant, Gopal Swami, who was my father. So it was, "Dear Gopal Swami, I met Gopal Swami today." And that's how that letter starts off. It's here in the Nehru Museum. And it was very interesting. It boiled down to the following misunderstandings. Nehru, when and my father was involved in setting up of the All India Services, when he and Sardar handled Hyderabad, they found that the Razakars, who were the Hyderabad civil servants, were hated by the people because they persecuted people there of one particular community. And K.M. Munshi, who became the administrator, recommended they all be sacked. Sardar consulted my father, who was the secretary dealing with it, and my father said that, look, it's okay, you can sack them, but you have 565 states. The civil servants in all these states will start feeling insecure ki hum kabhi kab nikalenge, hamari bari kab aayegi. So let's not do it in a hurry. We will give them good postings. There are two neighboring presidencies, the Madras presidency and the Bombay presidency. We will pack them off to the Bombay presidency. So that's what happened. And those fellows went and complained within 5 days of Sardar's death to Panditji, who was fretting and fuming when he summoned my father. And my father stood his ground, saying that these were the circumstances. So hence the irritated letter. But in fairness to Panditji, he forgot about it. And time moved on and we moved on in life. My only regret was that as a secretary of the government of India, my father lived in 11 Race Course Road. Now you know who occupies it. So my claim to glory and fame lies for very silly reasons of having lived in 11 Race Course Road in the 1950s. But coming to the more serious matters, I think if you see this exhibition, I would urge you see it. Because everything which is contained here, you will find tallying with real-life documented evidence that we've put together. We not only looked at the archives, we looked at the British archives, we looked at, for example, Kashmir's integration. You know, there was a lot of dilly-dallying. Panditji was unwilling to take a decision because Mountbatten was pressurizing him against doing it. The British were playing a double game. And then Manekshaw writes in his memoirs how the then Brigadier Manekshaw, head of military operations, was sent along with V.P. Menon to tell the Maharaja ki idhar dastakhat karo, or the Pakistanis will take you over. And how even aircraft were ready to take off with the first battalion being flown into Srinagar at that point in time when the Maharaja was in Jammu. So each one of these states, its integration was something to be borne in mind. But I think before you see this exhibition, you must read the book. Because this gives you a real life picture of what is said in this book by all its eminent writers. And you've seen the various chapters which are there. And also what we did a study of, and again this was, I must give it to, it is the Prime Minister's idea, that, dekhe, iska tulna kijiye ki humne kya kiya, aur Germany mein kya hua, ekatrit karne ke liye, and Italy mein kya hua. So he had done his history studies carefully. In the 19th century, Italy and Germany were united. I mean, compared to the problems we faced, that was a cakewalk. You will appreciate, and I think this is what is the point to be put across, and this really the PM was very clear that we should emphasize on, was the comparison with Garibaldi and Bismarck. And if you see, we have done our best in the short time available to put this together. But as I said, for those of you who want to do scholarly studies on this, I would suggest that you have a look at this book, the exhibition, and also I think some studies in the India Office Library in London would be worth it. Because we have to keep how this history evolved. And the fact of the matter was that it was within this booklet you will find, we have dwelt on the challenges which they faced, briefly written, and also the specific princely states. I mean, taking over a princely state like, say, Junagadh, involved a very delicate exercise, because the more or less de facto ruler at that point in time was a gentleman called Sir Sharnawas Khan Bhutto, father of Zulfikar Ali Bhutto. So that is interesting, because all this was a part of the Bombay presidency, apart from the princely states. And the Bhutto family really moved on to Bombay. But the Jinnah connection comes through and through. That was one part of this integration which I think everybody needs to study. The other point which I would like to make is we now see the interesting things happening in other princely states. But, Jinnah was looking more than just a separate state for Muslims. He was looking at a Balkanized India. There is extensive documentary evidence to show how he reached out as far as Junagadh to Travancore Cochin to stall them from integrating with India. We're now famous lookout for a corridor between East and West Pakistan, very much in his mind. Even putting thoughts into the ideas, minds of Maharajas like Jodhpur, Indore, Baroda also. So I think it was a fascinating period, because if you look at this, and look at the challenges which they faced at that point in time, It is something remarkable. I've spoken abroad. Someone I'm asked, what is it you are proud most about your country? And my answer is, never in human history have so many people with so many languages, with so many, embracing so many religions, with so many different cultural affinities and even dietary habits, lived together in one nation state. So what the achievement really was of Sardar and others was of this unique experiment giving us a unique position in the world. I mean, you can have wealth, even Donald Trump has wealth, but you can have a lot of resources. All the Arab countries have a lot of resources of oil, as they say, oil under the soil. But what is unique about any of those, you would have to think. But look back on human history. The experiment with Sardar, Panditji, everybody else, led of course by Mahatma Gandhi, were able to forge was this unique unity. Unity were based on diversity and respect for diversity. So, as I said, this book deals with it. They deal with his political ideas. Foreign policy, as I said, the letter of Patel to Nehru is well recorded. But one could sense, if you go through this, but Nehru was educated from school onwards in England. Therefore, while certainly discovery of India reflected his deep commitment to the soul of India, he went along very carefully, not overlooking the advice of the Viceroy. And in the case of Kashmir, that caused us very serious problems. And if you go through the Manekshaw documents, I think it's with his daughter at the present moment, you will find how close we came to disaster. Because Jinnah had moved to Lahore. They were planning to move in. Even Bhopal had its huge problems. Manipur had its problems. The interesting point was that despite Pakistani inducements, you had people like Maharaja of Travancore Cochin, and you had other states also, which there's one chapter called The Unusual Story of Aundh, which was the most remarkable integration in India of the states. So I do wish that more people would have a look at this narrative and in your writings, drawing from this, if you could see this exhibition and add on some more, you would be doing for succeeding generations a great job. Because, you know, and even in the exhibition, I mean, look at Sardar Patel's problems. It's vicious communal riots, millions moving across borders. Again, unparalleled in world history. You're dealing with a newborn country while dealing with these issues, apart from the major factor of uniting it. And therefore, what emerged in India is quite different. We are not a federal society. We are not certainly sort of presidential democracy. We are not a prime ministerial, exclusively prime ministerial democracy like you have in smaller countries. And if you look at any one of our neighbors, and I speak of Pakistan and to a lesser extent Bangladesh, it's prone to typical military takeovers. Democracy is a luxury, you know. And the fact is we've worked it out. And even from the beginning, the very clear thing, when the army will intervene, how it will intervene, was all spelt out by the steps the members of the cabinet took. So Shakti ji and Professor Roy, thank you so much. I am not very academically inclined, but it has been a pleasure for me to remember my younger days when the Prime Minister gave me this opportunity to deal with this and project. It brought back memories of a childhood, but it was an education for me. At an age when one had well crossed into the 70s. So it was life is continually a learning exercise. Shakti, I've learned a lot from you, and thank you, Professor Saab. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Now request you to present this investish. Thank you. Before I request my co-editor Himanshu Roy to speak, Just a word about the cover of this. It's sepia toned. The original cover, which I agreed to be outvoted wrongly, much darker. And you can see here the stains of a cup of tea. Just the stains showing. And people said, ki nahi nahi, aapko Patel ka ek aisa buland banana chahiye tha. And I said, no, the publisher had offered us two options. The reason I preferred that was the sepia toned paper, the stained cup of tea, basically history. What have we done? How have we forgotten? And which is why. But then people had like, and I even presented to the Prime Minister and I showed him and I told him why I have done that. But then I was persuaded by dear friends who felt ki nahi, thoda to shobha dega. Today I feel compromised that this actually is not a good idea. I feel that the stronger impact would have been on the old paper with the tea ka. You know, you can see the chai ka ye.
Cup of tea ka,
you know.
May I add one little anecdote? Sorry, Shakti. Of the Prime Minister, we asked him to come and his eye for detail. We asked him to come and see the exhibition the day before it was released. So he came and looked around very quickly. At the last exhibit was a mannequin of Sardar Patel sitting on his table with a pen in his hand and signing a document. So as we were going out, he said, Parsati ji, achha raha, lekin ek choti si wahan correction karna padega. I said, kya baat hai? He said, wo jo kalam aapne Sardar Patel ke haath mein likha hai, wo aajkal ka kalam hai, us zamane ka kalam nahi hai.
Absolutely. One must really be authentic in every which way. Himanshu ji, 15 minute aap boliye aur phir mil lena.
Thanks. My study began in 2014 October regarding on Patel, when I got a call from the Vice Chancellor Gwalior University to speak on 31st October, his birthday, official birthday, 31st October. Original dusra hai. Original birthday confirmed nahi hai, but either 31st April, 30th April or 7th May, as for his elder brother's genealogy. Form mein, matric ke form mein, Patel ne dal diya tha suddenly at a spurt of the moment, 31st October. So that has become official date of birth. So in order to deliver on 31st October, I began my reading. I was given only 7 days time to prepare my lecture. And that's how I began my reading on Patel. But then that simultaneously reflects the short of knowledge that we are taught as a student in the schools and in the universities, in the colleges. We don't have absolutely any idea about Patel except that he was a national integrator. This reflects, it may be deliberate design. Patel is never taught in the syllabus. It's not part of the syllabus. I, as a student of Delhi University for the last, and here we have been for the last 36 years, we do not teach Patel. So I was absolutely, had no idea to deliver in university, academia, a lecture on Patel. I had to reread as a fresh graduate student. But then when I began reading on Patel, I found him a fascinating personality. A very fascinating personality, the iron will, the determination. And then I made, because I had read Nehru a lot, I had read Gandhi a lot, and all the other modern personalities a lot from Raja Ram Mohan Roy onwards, but I hadn't read Patel. So when I began the comparison, I found here is a man, look how he is far ahead of the others, and still we do not know about him. That's the tragic part of the public discourse and the academic discourse that we had in this country after his death. what I learned about Patel in the last 4 years, and then subsequently my co-editor had shared with you that we had a workshop here and the book came out. The alternative narrative that he shared, the moderator. In 1916 he joined, October 1916 Sardar Patel joined as a, Sardar of course he became later on, we all know. But in politics he joined in October 1916. And within a short span he moved to look after as an administrator into the Ahmedabad municipality. This is a time of 3, 4, 5 years when 3, 4 prominent personalities are running the municipality, whether in Chennai, whether in Allahabad, Jawaharlal Nehru was there of course in Allahabad, whether in Calcutta. And when I make a comparison of these 4 personalities running the municipal corporations in the respective cities, I found the functioning of Sardar Patel as a municipality entirely different. His working style was different. Subah mein 6 baje, jab wo brush kar rahe hote the, or for the morning walk, he used to go into the municipal wards, interact with the locals, residents and the citizens there. Kya problem hai, batao? At 10 o'clock, when he used to come to the office, he used to send his officials. Keep it in mind, he used to come or send his officials to the problems where he was witness to in the morning hours. It means the personnel, the estate, the administration going to the citizens. Look at the consultative and the democratic process that he adopts right from the very beginning. He was not a mass leader, he was not a political leader, he was primarily a lawyer, but look at the attitude of the man. The administration going to the ordinary citizens, and then and there, if it's possible, the problems were sorted out. By 10, 11, most of the problems, the common problems that we face in the municipal wards of our residential colonies, that were sorted out. At the same time, in the municipal corporation, and I'm not running down any person, it's a comparison for a learning process. Nehru is writing letters to resign and grumbling about the prevalent corruption in Allahabad municipality in 1920s. We don't find this kind of letters and the threat of resigning and a comparison thereof, the administration not doing much of the works. This is one remarkable facet that I learned, which I was totally unaware of 4 years ago in the month of October when I began my reading. And the lesson that I learned, how the administration should function. Of course, subsequently, he headed the Ahmedabad municipality. 2 remarkable things he did. One, for the first time, the group housing society was formed in 1920s. 26, precisely. First time. Because in order to widen the roads of the old Ahmedabad, there was a protest from the residents. So he went there, asked the residents, you tell me the alternative. We all are fed up with the traffic problems. Now you tell me the solution of it. And the residents had no solution except to break the old walls, some of the residences, widen the roads, and then shift these areas, locality, in a group housing society very nearby. And all willingly accepted it. So the cooperation of the residents seeking solution from the problem from the residents, that is from the ordinary citizens. The another lesson that we need to learn. And the politicians and the administrators, and we in the academic should also learn from the practical experiences of a man. Second, his phase that comes after is around 34 when he begins to head the Congress Parliamentary Board. From 1934 to 1950, it was he who was the fundraiser of the party. And let me link immediately with this. When he died in 1950, and I was sharing with him the information that I had, and it was on the suggestion of the my co-editor that you read this book. Kurian, the milkman, had written an autobiography. And in the autobiography, he is citing Patel's daughter, Maniben. And Maniben is saying that in 1950, when her father died, he went with 35 lakhs rupees, and the Bahi Khata, who had donated, on the recommendation of his father, that hand over this money and the Bahi Khata straight to only Jawahar, none else. So she goes to the Prime Minister's office at his residence or Teen Murthy, of course, hands over the money, 35 lakhs rupees, in those years in 1950, and the Bahi Khata, who had donated. And the Prime Minister didn't ask much, took the money, the Bahi Khata, and she left. So when Kurian asks this lady, Maniben, because Maniben was also involved, and the idea was of Sardar Patel, this Amul. Amul was formed courtesy Sardar Patel in 1949, if my memory doesn't fail, the years that I'm talking about. And Maniben, gradually after the death of her father, was actively involved. And Kurian writes in his autobiography that she gave us the motherly support. He is using the word motherly treatment and motherly support about Maniben. And then Maniben was asked by Kurian, what you were expecting from the Prime Minister when you had gone to give the money to him, the party money. See, he didn't ask me anything about mere ghar mein kuch bhi nahi tha khane ko, main kahan rahungi, kya khaungi, kya kapde, mere paas kuch bhi nahi tha. He didn't ask. So that was shocking to the lady whose colleague they were together, her father's and the Prime Minister together for 30-35 years since 1916. So in 1940, the second was 1934 phase, when we find Sardar began to control or to elect the candidates for the provincial assembly elections. It was he broadly, a committee of 4-5, but it was he who primarily or predominantly selected the candidates, because he had the mandate from Gandhi. The Mahatma himself had told him ki ye jitne provincial assembly hain aur elections hain aur inke candidates hain aur wo sari cheeze ye aap dekhoge. And since 1934 it was Sardar Patel, that is the second part of his the administrative side and the political side that I am sharing with you, that he looked after till 1950. The third phase that I came to know about him, of course, and we all know, was when he joined first in 1946 as an interim government. If I'm correct, on 1st September or 2nd September 1946, the ministry was formed, of course, Nehru as the vice president technically, and then Sardar as the home minister. And subsequently, of course, when independence came, we know his role. But before independence, we have all talked about the integration. But more important than the integration, in the Maniben diary, which I saw, there are crucial period between in 1946, last week of December, and the first week of January. That is, first week of January of 1947, and the last week of December of 1946, when he took a crucial decision, because V.P. Menon is meeting him time and again almost every day or twice a day and reporting what's going on. In India, the role of the Muslim League, and in Jinnah in particular, that he was talking about the balkanization aspect. So he theoretically made up his mind that if it comes to ultimately, let's give the minimum of territory to Muslim League and Jinnah and do away with it. Nasur ko khatam karo, bahut ho gaya. And if the cancer has to be operated upon, it has to be operated upon. So the first decision, he made up the mind literally. That's the information or the message that I got. The last week of December after 25th and the first week of January that the he made up his mind. But of course, we all know the final decision was taken regarding partition in around 1947, officially on 3rd, 4th June 1947. But the course of development that was taking shape, and when he joined the ministry in 1946, he was in position to see very closely how the British officials and covertly the others were for Balkanization of India. Gradually it was moving on. And then subsequently the integration part starts when the partition process was completed. Simultaneously the integration as well. The partition decision was taken and then the integration process. And then after the integration, the reorganization of the states, the princely states and the administration and all the procedures that and the reactions that we find that he shared, transfer of the officials and other things. The work of integration of 565 states, and he rightly points out, was much greater than the role of Bismarck and Garibaldi. Had Jinnah not played a role even in Jammu and Kashmir, in Junagadh and in Hyderabad, without firing a shot, the 565 princely states would have been integrated non-violently. Of course, 562 were integrated non-violently in a very ahimsak way. The problem was only three states. Even in Junagadh, there was not much of a firing. It was very peaceful. Yes, in Hyderabad, there was the army intervened. And of course, we know the entire story in Jammu and Kashmir. When I began to read, and the chapter is there, when I began to read about Jammu and Kashmir, had Patel not intervened at a very decisive moment, look at the man. Menon is coming from the flight, and his minister is waiting to gather the first-hand news, waiting for him, breaking all the protocols to receive him at the port. Kya hua? Jaldi batao. What is the development? Instead of waiting for him to come through his car and the office and in the office, he goes, the minister goes to airport. Look at the urgency and the determination of the man. Even after the Jammu and Kashmir, and this is not so much known in the public, Patel had a feeling, because I feel that it was only Patel who could understand Jinnah. Neither Gandhi nor Nehru. He had the feeling, Patel, that Jinnah could be talked to for the exchange of the territories. Let's have now East Pakistan part of India. Have your Kashmir Valley, not the entire Jammu and Kashmir. Had Kashmir Valley, you take away Kashmir Valley, merge it with your Pakistan, but in lieu of that, we'll have East Pakistan, now Bangladesh. In 48, he was contemplating. But unfortunately, he was not expecting, he was not known, he was not knowing that Jinnah will die. And Jinnah died in 48. And with that the story of September 48. So with that the story ended. But the contemplation, the idea was there, and he was damn sure that Jinnah will agree for the exchange of territory. had that taken place, there would have been no 1971 and there would have been no recurring Jammu and Kashmir, because that would have been through mutual consent. And of course, his role in the foreign policy. He was the person in 1948 who suggested Nehru to recognize Israel. And then he is writing a letter to Jawaharlal Nehru, his bosom friend and the Prime Minister, that let's not mix up religion with politics in the making of the foreign policy. To a secular Jawaharlal, a communal, within, of course, inverted comma, a communal Sardar Patel is saying, please do not mix up religion with politics for the sake of internal and external minorities. Recognize Israel. In 48 he's writing. And then he was talking about the 7th, 6th June letter of 1950. I read the 4th June of 1949 letter, which he's writing to Jawaharlal Nehru, his Prime Minister. That think of, contemplate of recognizing Tibet as a politically sovereign state when Communist Party led by Mao had not yet entered into Tibet. 4th June 1949. Let's think of. And then the idea, Attlee was the Prime Minister. The Prime Minister of India sends a demarche to Attlee for what to do. And Patel is writing, do consult me please before you send this letter to Attlee. The Prime Minister doesn't consult him. Simply says, reports that I have already sent the letter to Attlee. So in the, and not this planning commission that came out. The planning commission that was earlier being formed, Patel had played a role in the making of the budgetary provisions. Patel played a role. So in the economic affairs that he was talking about, in the making of the foreign policy, as an administrator, as an integrator, one of his bosom friend was a Muslim from his childhood days. Of course, in Lucknow, in Calcutta, at two places that I read his speeches, he clearly says to the Muslims in particular, when Pakistan has invaded us, why don't you take a stand and be critical of Pakistan? And then he is saying, you decide whether you have to leave or you stay. You are free to join Pakistan. One very important thing, Ambedkar, as a chairman of the drafting committee, as a member of the Constituent Assembly, it was courtesy Patel. I read the letter, a correspondence, two letters that were exchanged between Gandhi and Patel, where Gandhi was apprehensive about Ambedkar. But Patel is saying, no, I have talked to him, I have a full faith. Let's bring Ambedkar into the Constituent Assembly and make him the chairman of the drafting committee. It was not Jawaharlal Nehru. So with this, I end. Thank you very much, sir. Okay, next up. We can have some contributors. Please. But just a moment. We'll have the question answer later on, sir. Some of our contributors who are here. Bhuvan or Pranjal, anyone who is here who wish to speak on any aspect or any.
Well, I wrote a chapter on Patel, Muslim League, and the Hindu nationalists, and one of the most